Hello, I'm Eli Darkash, Director of Compliance for Feeding Northeast Florida, and today we're going to be talking about Standard Operating Procedures, or SOPs for short. This is something we need to do every year as part of requirements from Feeding America, so this is an annual refresher. Hopefully you know all this stuff and doing this stuff already, but if you learn something, that's great too. So we're going to be looking at 16 procedures today, alphabetically A to Z. And so if you have any questions after we're done, feel free to contact me and I'd be happy to address them for you. So let's get started. First, we're going to be talking about allergens control program. Allergens control is a term that refers to common food types that people have allergies to. And so basically the major food commodities that comprise the big eight allergens, which comprise about 97% of food allergies, includes milk, eggs, peanuts, wheat, soy, fish, shellfish, and tree nuts. Now you may notice that milk and eggs are two separate allergens. A lot of times people confuse and just think that's dairy. They do need to be handled separately. And so when we think about those eight commodities, anytime we receive them, we store them, we handle them, or we distribute them, there's specific procedures we need to follow to make sure that we're not having cross-contact risk of them, the allergens going to a non-allergen product that can make someone very sick. Now, if you've ever known someone with a food allergy, they don't even have to eat a whole lot of it or even eat any of it. If they just be around it, it can cause hives, it can cause difficulty of breathing to severity of almost even fatal and death. So we want to be really careful how we handle those types of items specifically. So for example, if we're going to be receiving pallets of allergens, we use orange tags. These orange pallet tags identify these products as allergens, and they need to be received separately from other product. And what that means is, let's say, for example, we get a pallet of milk or a pallet of eggs in. The orange tag needs to be put on the front of the pallet, and then that pallet needs to make sure it's not stored above anything else. So if you put it in the cooler, for example, and in the rack, you only want to make sure that eggs are on top of eggs or dairy's on top of dairy. You just want to make sure basically that you keep those allergens separated and on top of each other only. So for example, for storing and handling, when you're pulling an order, you're selecting a pallet, and you have pallets on top of each other that are allergens, you want to select the top one first. Because if you select the bottom one and someone else comes in behind you and puts a non-allergen pallet underneath that pallet, then you run the risk of eggs or milk spilling onto that pallet, and you just have cross-contact risk. So when you select pallets for distribution or to go to the share floor, always select the pallet on top in the rack if they're above each other. Another thing to consider is when you're loading agency vehicles. So let's say, for example, an agency has several different types of product that they're going to be loading into the vehicles. You want to make sure that they do not load allergens on top of anything else in their vehicles. So if they have cases of eggs or cases at the case level, you want to make sure that's on the bottom or separate from any other product for the same reason. You don't want to have that risk of cross contact. So if there is any type of spill or leak of allergens, let's say egg spill or milk spills, it's really important that you handle it correctly. What that means is you want to use disposable gloves that you can throw away after you're finished cleaning it up. You want to disinfect the area after you clean it. So let's say, for example, you're using a mop, mop bucket, you want to take out that mop head after you're done cleaning it and putting it in the dirty laundry before you clean anything else. I'll put a new mop head on, empty out that mop bucket and clean that out. Use, if it's a smaller spill or leak, use a Clorox wipe or something along those lines. And after you have it all cleaned and disinfected, then you want to make sure you throw away your gloves and change gloves before you do anything else. Those are very important steps to take before any activity resumes. That is it for allergen control program. Next, we're going to be talking about bloodborne pathogens. And this basically addresses the spills of blood or other body fluids. This is not primarily a first aid or emergency response procedure we're talking about. We're talking about from a perspective of food safety and where there's food product in the area. So, the first thing to consider when you have this type of situation is your hand care. So it's really important to wear latex gloves especially if you have any type of cuts or abrasions or chapped or dermatitis, anything along those lines. Also, if you're examining someone with an open wound that is bleeding, really be careful not to examine their wound if you have bare hands, because that is a risk of transferring whatever they may have in their bloodstream to your open cuts. Remember, if you're handling blood or body secretions, you know, make sure you wear latex gloves. And always, always wash your hands as soon as possible after you handle any type of infectious material, as well as after you remove your gloves and protect any protective equipment or clothing. Always wash your hands after that. It's really important. Also, obviously, all production needs to stop in the area until that blood or body fluids are contained and removed. You don't want people to keep on working around you that has a potential risk of that transfer. And then obviously you want to dispose of that contaminated product immediately. Do not rework any product, trying to figure out what contains blood and what doesn't. If when in doubt, you're going to throw it out. And disinfect the area with bleach, any product contact areas prior to resuming that activity. So whatever maybe the pallet with the case was sitting on, you want to disinfect that surface area as well. If anyone has suffered exposure to another person's bodily fluids, they must report that immediately to the supervisor or COO. At that point, we're going to do confidential testing as soon as possible to determine if a virus was transmitted, and then retest it at 6 weeks and 12 weeks and 6 months. So we take it very seriously, and that's why you want to take these precautions to make sure that there's no chance of that transfer. And that is bloodborne pathogens control. Okay, next we're going to be talking about chemical control program. And this refers to two different types of uses that we would either receive chemicals for purpose of distribution to our agency network, or the chemicals that we use in the facility to do our sanitation and cleaning. Both these scenarios, these measures need to be taken to make sure there's no chance of the chemicals being transferred to food as a food safety risk. So first you want to consider is the receiving process of when we get chemicals into the warehouse. Obviously you want to make sure there's absolutely no open packaging whatsoever. It needs to be sealed tight in its original packaging if we're going to either use it in our inventory or use it in the facility. The first time it comes in, it needs to be sealed. Also needs to have the safety data sheet. So we can make sure that if there were an emergency that happened, whether it be gets in someone's eyes or ingested or anything else, skin, anything else like that, if it's combustible, if it's flammable, what emergency procedures and first aid needs to happen is all located in the safety data sheet. So we're going to talk about that in a little bit. As far as when we store the inventory or store chemical product we're going to use in the warehouse, it needs to be away from food product. That's the bottom line. So we do have a back aisle with the red and white striped racking that we use specifically for non-food to keep that separate from food product. We also have a chemical cabinet that we use for the in-house use to make sure that's separate from food inventory as well. We need to make sure that when we do use, let's say, spray bottles or any of the other type of chemicals, we need to put that back in the chemical cabinet when we're done, not leave it out and about. When we're pulling orders that has chemicals on it for agencies for distribution, we make sure those chemicals are on the bottom of the pallet and not above or hanging over any type of food product that could be a risk if it leaks or anything like that. Always make sure it's on the bottom. As well as when we're loading agency vehicles, make sure if there's any type of chemical cases or pallets or anything like that, make sure they're on the bottom as well. Make sure there's no chance of any type of transfer. When we're using chemicals, there are only approved chemicals that are permitted, meaning they have the safety data sheets and so forth. So I'm going to go over some of the uses of the chemicals we get from the chem station, which is already diluted, doesn't need to be diluted any further, and we already have approved for food facility and so forth. So for example, the FC1 floor cleaner is used for mopping floors and cleaning out truck beds and so forth. The DS1 disinfectant is used on the bathrooms, toilets, sinks, and so forth. It's really important anytime we clean bathrooms to use green tape handle utensils only. What that means is the mops and the mop buckets, broom dustpan, We have a separate set of utensils just for restroom cleaning. That's the only place you can use those utensils. Don't use it anywhere else in the warehouse. And likewise, don't use anything else in the warehouse in the restrooms. GL1 glass cleaners used in office windows and bathroom mirrors. FC4 neutral floor cleaners used for office floors. We do have an odor remover fragrance that's used in the floor scrubber machine. DEF fluids used in the vehicle DEF fluid tanks. As far as air fresheners or antibacterial wipes, only use the ones that we have approved with SDS sheets. Bleach obviously is used to clean the hoppers or blood spills or break room area, so forth. Any other chemicals in the warehouse are only used upon request by COO or director level, with the assumption that we do have the corresponding safety data sheet, and that could be like carpet or upholstery cleaner or stainless steel polish or paint or something along those lines. And so we're going to annually verify the effectiveness of this program. When you dispose chemicals, make sure it goes directly to the dumpster, preferably in a plastic bag if you have any type of open containers. But if there is a spill of any type of chemical, make sure any activity in the area stops immediately until that spill is taken care of. One last thing before we finish this program is I want to show you the safety data sheet book on top of the chemical cabinet. Here is where the hard copies are. If you need to have answer quickly on emergency procedures for a chemical you're working with. There's also an online library on the receiving and volunteer desktops. If you see this logo right here, you click on the logo, it has a library, you just type it in and it'll pop it out for you. So those are very accessible and handy for you. If you can't find what you're looking for, most SDS sheets are also online, you can Google them. So one way or another, we're gonna make sure you get the info you need very quickly. And that is it on chemical control program. Okay, next we're gonna be talking about consumer complaint response. And so obviously as a food bank, our goal is to provide safe and nutritious food to our clients and agencies. And so the purpose of this program is to identify required and recommended practices needed to address and respond to those clients or agencies that contact us with safety complaints. This program is not intended to address food quality or service problems. That's more of a best business, best practice, but this policy basically says we're going to address and resolve all food safety complaints from a director level leadership. We're going to communicate, and we've been trained to understand the difference between a food safety complaint and a food quality issue. So if they're a food safety issue, it requires immediate action according to this program. Basically, we're going to first determine if it's caused by improper storage, if it's caused by improper handling, or if it's caused by improper distribution. What was the root cause to make this food unsafe? And then it's obviously going to require immediate response and detailed documentation. You'll see the customer complaint form here is the form we're going to use when we have a complaint to get as much detail as possible to trace back from where we got it from, how much went through our system, where did it go, what's the gist of the complaint, basically, to collect that information, and so we can determine if it's a food safety or food quality issue. If it does turn out to be a food safety issue, we're going to immediately place all inventory on hold for further disposition at warehouses or agencies. We'll make sure all of our necessary people are informed, including our president, CEO, and management. Depending on the severity of the issue and the nature of the complaint, we may even notify the national office or regulatory authorities. So we're going to have a detailed listing of the distribution of this product traced back and then placed on our website, as well as direct calls and emails to clients to make sure that everyone's aware of the issue. Anything that has been placed on hold is going to be inspected, and if it is deemed safe or free, then it can be released and agencies notified. But if it's unsafe, it's going to be discarded. And then documentation is required and must be reported, maintained at our office. So bottom line, the feedback is a good thing. We don't want to discourage feedback because we have a continuous improvement philosophy. So we always want to make sure that Where we can improve in any area, we want to have an open mind to that. And that's pretty much it for consumer complaint response. Okay, next we're going to be talking about food defense and vulnerability assessment. So this program addresses and reduces the risk of intentional harm to the food bank or our employees or volunteers or products. Basically, what we're trying to do is reduce the likelihood of intentional food adulteration, identifying any source of threat, reducing the likelihood or impact of an attack, provisions to respond to an incident. So this is basically documenting processes used to evaluate, mitigate potential threats and vulnerabilities. And our goal is to maintain a safe working environment for our employees and volunteers, and as well as safe product to our client agencies and customers, and overall protect our food bank. So it addresses aspects like outside security, general inside security, shipping and receiving security, as well as personnel security. So just briefly, outside security, we have a perimeter fence outside the parking lot area that has an automated gate that's closed outside business hours. We also have adequate lighting in the parking lot, after hours. As well as cameras that are able to identify coming and going, basically. As far as general inside security, the front doors have passcode entry. We do have a camera system for surveillance. We have an alarm system, as well as adequate lighting, chemical program, as well as restricting access to areas depending on what the purpose is of the visitor. For shipping and receiving security, we have strong record-keeping measures, restricted access, as well as no return of product back to the facility once it's been distributed. And as far as personnel security, we do drug screening and background checks. We check for contractor bonds. We do not allow court-appointed volunteers. We do have strong record-keeping processes, as well as a sign-in process and badge system in place. And to round that off, we also have food safety training, GMP and GWP, which we'll go over in a little bit, which is good manufacturing practices, power equipment training, and so forth. So those are some of the measures that we take to ensure that we have as safe environment as possible. And that is food defense. Okay, next we're going to be talking about glass and brittle plastic program. The purpose is to make sure that no foreign glass or brittle plastic or ceramic pieces or shards, anything along those lines, or contaminate any food products. That would be a physical hazard of choking and that kind of thing. So we want to make sure that only essential glass, brittle plastics, or ceramics are present in the facility. So on the offices and desks and where people are, our workstations are, we want to make sure there's no trinkets or glass cups or anything that, mugs or anything like that, that could potentially chip or anything along those lines, that they should not be in the facility at all. So we have a checklist that requires the monthly inspection of each storage aisle in the dry, cooler, and freezer to make sure that any product that contains glass or brittle plastic, let's say if you have glass jars of pickles or whatever, make sure it's packaged correctly and it's in an unbroken state. And also make sure that there's sufficient lighting along with shielded bulbs and shielded fixtures. So if the forklift goes up to the roof, for example, it's not going to shatter any bulbs that would cause fragments to come down on product underneath it. So everything needs to be shielded. We also have a glass cleanup kit, which includes a separate broom and dustpan that's labeled accordingly. This needs to be used only for glass cleanup and nowhere else in the warehouse. And likewise, don't use any other type of utensils to clean up glass other than this broom and dustpan. If there is a breakage, we make sure you stop all activity and then clean and sanitize that immediate area, removing and disposing any potentially affected product. No rework, trying to figure out if it has glass or not. If you're in doubt, you're going to throw it out. And then we're going to document and date that location on the sanitation checklist to make sure that we have it purposes of identifying where that glass break happened. as far as what needs to be inspected on the sanitation checklist, that includes like dock light bulbs or overhead fluorescent bulbs, exit signs, mirrors in the bathrooms, obviously any product packaged in the glass jars, any shopping areas where we have glass jars, the lights on the forklifts, the clocks, the floor scales, flashlights, anywhere you can think of that may have potential glass or real plastic. This needs to be checked on a monthly basis to make sure that that hasn't been chipped or any type of shards have potential contamination. And that's basically how we handle the glass and brittle plastics. Okay, next we're going to be talking about good manufacturing and warehousing practices. These are considered GMPs and GWPs. All food facilities are required to have these. And these are minimum acceptable standards for operations, and it applies to all employees, volunteers, visitors entering or working the facility, including temporary personnel and contractors. These rules are applicable at all times, including downtime, weekends, and holidays. Any exceptions to these rules must be approved by management. And so, for example, the appearance, there should never be any flip-flops or sandals, any open-toed shoes. You should never have any torn or baggy pants. Shouldn't be any midriffs or halter tops. As far as personal habits, there should not be any open sores or illness. No sitting or standing on product or pallets. Hand washing obviously needs to occur at any time after eating, drinking, smoking, using the restroom. Hand washing is a big way to prevent any type of pathogen transfer. Disposable gloves if you're going to have any food contact, as well as changing those gloves out if you work with allergens and so forth. There should not be any personal food or drink or tobacco in any of the inventory areas other than the break and lunch areas. Obviously, no tobacco in the lunch areas, but personal food and drink should only be in lunch and break room areas only. What that means is you should not be having lollipops or gum or candy or coffee walking around the warehouse. That's a big no-no, because any type of spill can lead to pest control issues, slip and trip hazards, general cleanliness, and so forth. We need to make sure that not only that, the food in the warehouse inventory needs to have very accurate inventory protocol. And we don't want any type of mix between personal and donated and so forth. Along those lines, no consumption of inventory unless approved by the director. The food that was donated is donated specifically for a purpose as per IRS code, and we're not going to eat that inventory. As far as doors and screens, they should be closed when not in use. For pest control reasons, we want to keep birds out and anything that crawls and runs. Any pest evidence that we do see must be reported right away so we can address it immediately. And we want to keep everything off that white line pest control perimeter. We're going to talk about it in a little bit when we talk about the pest control program. Any safety hazard or injury must be reported immediately so we can address it immediately, not only from a medical care standpoint, but also how to prevent it from happening again to anyone else. Overall, you want to clean as you go. Again, to prevent those slip and trip hazards, but also to make the facility as presentable as possible. All trash cans and dumpsters must have closed lids. That, again, is for pest control reasons, to keep bugs and anything else out of our warehouse. Never set food cases directly on the floor. You want to segregate food from non-food product. Again, food cases directly on the floor would be a pest control hazard with bugs and so forth. And the reason we separate food from non-food goes back to our chemical control program and just overall keeping that food safe. And last thing on this list is the danger zone for high-risk foods. That danger zone is 41 degrees to 135 degrees. So we want to keep the cooler and freezer doors closed when they're not in use as much as possible, because when that temperature gets above 41 degrees, for example, that's when pathogens grow. And when it gets between 70 and 120, that's when they grow really, really fast. So we want to make sure if it's perishable product, we keep that product below 41 to keep those pathogens from spreading and bacteria from spreading. And that is it for the good manufacturing practices. Okay, next we're going to be talking about the HACCP Food Safety Program, which stands for Hazard Analysis Critical Control Points. And these are basically steps where food safety hazards are eliminated or reduced to acceptable levels where control is essential. So, for example, critical limits measures the values that establish parameters. So, for example, for temperature, you have parameters that's acceptable of what's in range and out of range. Or time is a critical limit, so you have measurable values of when it's too long for it to be out of temperature and so forth. There's food safety hazards like biological hazards and chemical hazards and physical hazards that can cause injury. So you want to be really careful in each of those categories. And so what we need to do is determine what to measure, how do we measure it, who's going to measure it, and how often is it going to be measured. Who's going to be notified if a deviation occurs, and how it's going to be corrected, how's it going to be recorded. These are all factors that goes into the HACCP plan. Also, the two main factors we measure include temperature and time, specifically with the perishable product. So we need to figure out where it came from and how we receive it. How is it packaged? How is it labeled? How do we store it? And how does it get distributed? Each of those questions have to be answered with certainty and specificity for us to be able to determine if the food is safe or not. So that all goes into our HACCP plan. A good example is seafood. Seafood has very specific concerns with histamines if it gets out of temperature range. So that's why we need to make sure seafood stays frozen solid the entire time. It's frozen solid when we receive it. It's frozen solid while we're storing it. And it stays frozen solid as we're distributing it. At no point should it thaw. If it does thaw, it needs to be thrown away and documented. And not only that, if it thaws, we need to disinfect the area that was around it. So that's an example of a HACCP plan as it relates to temperature and time controls. Okay, next we're going to be talking about HAZCOM or Hazard Communications. Of the OSHA general industry citations, this is one of the top 10 that commercial industry faces. The main way to address hazard communications is with label requirements. So anytime you have any type of hazardous chemical come in, for example, you make sure it has the product ID, make sure it has a hazard statement, make sure it has a pictogram, and make sure it has contact info. All those are required. Now, that being said, we're going to try to eliminate and reduce and prevent as much hazard materials as possible. For example, we do not want to have any flammable inventory, whether it be charcoal or lighters or butane or propane. None of that should be in our warehouse because of the risk. So you see, for example, in this pictorial, the categories and classes include the health hazards, carcinogens, and so forth. Flammable, exclamation mark would be like an irritant or a skin sensitizer. You have gas cylinders, gases under pressure. You have corrosion, exploding bomb. Obviously, we're not going to encounter that, hopefully. Flame over circle is an oxidizer. You have environment, like aquatic toxicity. And skull and crossbones would be acute toxicity. What we might encounter could include corrosion when you work with the battery acid for the power equipment. So for example, if you're working with the forklifts and pallet jacks to either water the batteries or to change out the batteries, you should be wearing gloves and shielded goggles, even an apron to protect yourself from any potential splatter of acid. And then if there is an acid or hydraulic leak or spill, it should be neutralized with a base or alkaline to make sure it doesn't spread. We find actually kitty litter works really well to be able to contain that spill. And so you want to be really careful not only to prevent it from coming in the warehouse and reject that type of product if you see it, but also you want to be careful how you dispose of it as well, making sure that you don't present a risk to anything else when that gets disposed. So that's basically the hazard communications. Okay, next we're going to be talking about non-conforming product and the quality control program. So this is necessary to implement measures to retain and trace products that do not comply with our quality standards, such as adulteration or labeling, packaging, product integrity, this type of quality control that we need to make sure our food is safe and nutritious. So this describes measures for proper handling and disposing, investigating issues that have that potential impact to our quality. So for example, if it's mislabeled or misbranded, we need to put that on hold until the packaging or labels have been corrected before it gets released to active inventory. If there's damage to the product, we need to make sure it's properly disposed, as well as written on the product disposal form, and proper adjustments are made to inventory. If it's received in from a vendor, we want to reject it or return it to the vendor. If it's only a portion of the product that's been damaged, that's going to be sorted and effect, so make sure it's isolated and disposed properly from good product. We do need to inspect 100% of our product prior to release. So nothing should go out to agency, to distribution, to clients without first being inspected. Absolutely nothing. So if it's a quality issue like a recall program, we do have a recall program in place. We're going to talk about that in a little bit as far as traceability. But we're going to make every attempt to retrieve product if there is a quality issue. As far as disposing product, obviously it should have a product number, date, and weight written on the disposal form so we can track that appropriately. That is the non-conforming product and quality control program. We do have quality control sheets in the volunteer area that they complete for each volunteer shift to verify that it was handled appropriately, including the weight, the quality, the tag, and the location. This is something they do every shift. All right, so next we're going to be talking about our pest control program. We take this very seriously. From a food safety standpoint, we need to control pests with at least the least possible impact to our people, our property, and our environment. And it includes internal and external components, from sanitation to construction of our facility to maintenance and housekeeping and so forth. So the fundamentals of the program include good housekeeping, exclusion of any potential pest, extermination, obviously, if evidence is found. We also want to eliminate any standing water and reduce any aged inventory, because both of those would be pest attractants. For example, if we have, or if we're mopping the facility, we don't want to leave water in the mop bucket overnight, because that's going to attract pests. Or you want to leave a wet mop head in the mop bucket, because that's going to attract bugs and flies and so forth. So after we're mopping, you want to make sure that at the end of the shift, the mop bucket's emptied and dry, and then the mop head should be in the dirty laundry basket, laundry bag. Any pest evidence needs to be addressed immediately, including rapid escalation expected for any help that's needed. We're not gonna wait on it. It's gonna be addressed right away. We want to document all instances of problems or evidence so we can see trends and do a trend analysis. Types of pests that we're looking for include rodents or birds or ants or roaches, stored product pests like weevils and beetles and moths, anything like that, it would be part of our program. The pest control provider is going to respond within 24 hours. And only that pest control company may perform services. So our employees should not be doing pest control. We do have a professional service that they're going to check at least monthly, but we do internal walk-arounds to inspect for evidence that we then would report to the pest control company. We do have an 18-inch white line perimeter around the facility for rodent control, where you see the rodent traps. Nothing else should be on this line, and the reason being is that rodents have very poor eyesight and they travel with their whiskers along the walls. So we don't want to direct those rodents into the middle of the warehouse. We want to make sure their path goes directly to the traps. And also, by cleaning that white line regularly, we can see evidence of, let's say, droppings or chew marks or anything else that will let us know that there's an issue. Likewise, we want to keep doors and screens closed when not in use. The facility should be sealed and screened at all times, and that's to prevent birds from coming in. So birds carry diseases, and once a bird gets into a warehouse, it's really hard to get them out because you have high ceilings, you have a food source in our facility, and nesting opportunities and so forth. So if birds get in, we want to get them out as soon as possible. If we can't get it on our own by measures like keeping the lights out and having them attracted to the outdoor light or sound, ways of directing them or so forth, we're going to call the experts in if we can't get them out. And lastly, we want to reject any shipments of inventory coming in. If there's any pest evidence, we want to identify and notify the supplier that, hey, there's pest evidence in this load. We cannot accept it. And you need to address what's going on at your facility with it. So we do have a form. Our donation receipt needs to be filled out on the bottom for any product coming in to make sure that it's documented that we're inspecting everything coming in to make sure there's no possible entry or evidence. And that is the pest control program. Next, we're going to be talking about the recall program and traceability. This program basically identifies our measures we take to establish an effective and targeted program so our agencies and clients can benefit from the safe and wholesome food. We have procedures for quick and controlled removal of product. The notice is possibly issued from the health department or local donors or Feeding America National Office, or it might be a national recall that's put out by the FDA or USDA. We get those notices in on a regular basis. So when those notices come in, our recall team includes operations and agency relations, donor relations, as well as volunteer management. And so we have an ongoing system that we maintain accurate and timely inventory of our product. It includes our incoming receipts, our bill of ladings, our inventory rework and adjustments, as well as the outbound invoices that are able to trace and track product by code and date and number of units. And that helps us in our recall steps, which is we need to verify the authenticity of that recall. So we're looking at the SKU and lot number, the description of the product, the expiration dating, possibly even a photo if available, and we want to assess that hazard likeliness. Is it likely to occur? Is it in the southeast region of the United States, or is it from donors that we regularly work with? What is the severity of the hazards? Is it a minor severity, or is it a very serious risk? So then we want to establish that course of corrective action by notifying the appropriate party. So, for example, if it was something that is from our retail partners, we make sure all the retailers are aware of it, as well as the retail agencies that do pickups on our behalf. We definitely want to notify all the agencies that may have come across this product, or even our volunteers that may be seeing the product when they're reworking, make sure our receiving team is aware of it, so we can identify, number one, if we've received it, number two, how much of it we received it through our system, as well as how much has been distributed and where it went to. So we can trace, you know, all the way back to let the national office know, so they can track how much of that recalled product went through our inventory. So all that is really important to make sure that no one gets sick from the product that goes through our system, to make sure, again, that safe and wholesome food is our goal. So if we find a recall product, it's really important that we place that product on hold so we can verify it. If it is recalled product, after we notify Feeding America that we've identified it, then we make sure that it gets thrown away and discarded so there's no chance of it getting distributed. In addition to those actual recalls that we are checking on a regular basis, we also should conduct mock recalls twice a year to make sure that we're fresh in the process, to make sure everyone is on their toes and ready to go with it. All right, so next we're going to be talking about receiving procedures and rejection of shipments. So the goal here is to identify and bar entry of any potentially contaminated materials. This includes raw materials or finished product or returned goods, equipment, and so forth. So we want to reject shipments if there's any type of damage or infestation or dirty transportation or materials, mold, leak, foul odor, anything like that at all. We want to identify up front before it even gets to our facility or inside our facility. It again is included with the safe and wholesome food we want to distribute. So we want to make sure that any shuttle vehicles are clean, free of holes, free of infestation. We definitely want to use our receiving documentation to make sure that any perishable and frozen product meets minimum temperature requirements using temp guns during the receiving process, during the inventory process, during distribution processes. Do not compromise these standards during the receiving process. For example, if we receive perishable product, we don't want to stack that on the dock before it goes in the cooler, because your dock is most likely at least room temperature, and that's going to raise that temperature of your product. So you want to make sure you take advantage of the reefer vehicle as well as the refrigeration in your cooler to keep that product at temperature as much as possible. You want to stack that product. Definitely document your temperature checks, document the product condition, and maintain records of any rejected shipments that may include defects. So that way we can track any trends and show that we're taking the steps necessary to bar any entry of those potential items. And that's the receiving procedures and rejected shipments steps that we want to take. All right. Next, we're going to be talking about regulatory affairs and inspections. Sometimes, occasionally, we get pop-in inspections from the USDA or FDA or Health Department that they're just doing their job to make sure that we're operating the way we should be. So we want to develop those effective, cooperative, professional relationships with these authorities. And it starts with preparation and planning. So we want to show the operations hours that are posted. We want to make sure the director level and above is prepared to accompany those regulators so they're not just on their own walking through your facility. You do want to prohibit any camera recording devices unless there's prior approval granted through a written request to protect yourself. And then also, you do want to make available any written documents as well as access. We will provide an office if needed for the regulator. And our personnel is going to be available to answer any questions they have as a professional courtesy. So as far as inspection and protocol, the regulator should be presenting their photo ID, their business card, as well as comply with our food bank policies, like for example our GMPs. They want to do the sign-in process and receive a visitor badge. Your best practice is even to call their agency to verify the inspector is supposed to be there. You want to inquire if the inspection is routine or if it's investigative or if it's cause. Make sure our response is targeted and specific. We don't want to provide unsolicited info. Take good notes of the conversation and make copies of any documents, or if you provide any samples, keep a copy of that sample. You can accept their written reports, but you should not be signing any of their forms until you verify it with our senior management. So that's basically how we handle those pop-in inspections. Again, I want to reiterate, you want to be professional and courteous, but also protect our interests so we're not putting ourselves at risk. Okay, the last thing I'm going to go over today is our storage practices. So these are basically required and recommended practices for specific procedures that were compliant, as well as supporting a comprehensive food safety program. So I'm just going to go over these one at a time. So we want to make sure our materials are stored and removed from storage in a way that's going to prevent contamination. So all areas must be clean, well ventilated. It includes raw materials and packaging, work in process, finished products, and so forth. We need to have systems to facilitate that stock rotation are present by either FIFO or FIFO. FIFO is first in, first out. FIFO is first expired, first out. So what that means, for example, is if we have dry pallets, we want to select the oldest pallet tags first. If we're going to do any type of volunteer sorting or volunteer inspection, if we're going to do order picking or distribution, make sure you pick those oldest tags first. For the cooler, again, you want to select the oldest pallet tags first for distribution, for either pickup or delivery. But make sure that, since it's such short shelf life, we're inspecting that product before releasing it. And then for the freezer, again, we have trailers staged based on process. So you have an incoming trailer that needs inspection. You have an outgoing trailer that's already been inspected. You have a trailer for non-meat and so forth. So on a weekly basis, we should be flipping our frozen inventory so the oldest pallets are on the tail end and not stuck in the nose. Our materials should always be off the floor on pallets. Again, for food safety and pest control reasons, we don't want to have materials directly on the floor. Adequate spacing should be maintained for access to cleaning and inspection and pest control. Stored slots and traffic lanes should be provided for items at floor level. No material should be stored outside, exposed to deterioration or contamination. So that means that we're not going to store our pallets outside. We're not going to have any product overnight on the dock or anything like that. We want to keep everything indoors. Special handling considerations for safety risk product. So, for example, allergens and glass and chemicals, so forth, with documented failures and corrective actions, we have those programs in place. Returned products are not available for use until inspected and dispositioned by the director level. If we have any insect-susceptible materials in storage for longer than 4 weeks, they need to be reinspected due to the insect life cycle. So what that means is, for example, if we have rice or grains or pasta or cereals that we've had inventory for more than 4 weeks, we need to reinspect them because that's where you have concern of weevils. Weevils are basically beetles that their larva is inherently in the sealed packaging that they hatch and release these live bugs after 4 weeks. So we want to make sure there's no weevils running around inside those rice, grains, pasta, and cereals, that kind of thing. It's actually a good idea to store those inside the cooler instead of out in the dry warehouse. Also, food contact containers are covered or inverted while in storage to prevent contamination from overhead structures. So, for example, if we're going to put our food drive barrels up in the racks, we want to have them upside down so they're not collecting anything from overhead. Likewise, if we have any type of open Gaylord bins of produce, like farm bulk produce, we make sure there's a pallet topper on top to protect it, as well as in the freezer. Any frozen pallets should have a pallet topper on them to protect them from the condensation dripping down from the trailer roof. And that can happen if you have the doors open and closing with we make sure that the temperature stays consistent. So the pallets we use should be clean and dry and good repair, used in a way that doesn't create a hazard risk to the materials or personnel. So we don't want to put anything up in the racks, for example, that's missing slats, because that can cause a wobbly or unsafe situation. Waste should be stored in properly identified containers, need to be cleaned and covered and emptied regularly. So, for example, our hoppers should be washed out if they have leaky juice in them, as well as obviously make sure our waste containers have lids and so forth. Single service containers should not be reused, so that's why we use liners for the Gaylord bins. That way we're not having any type of juice or leaky stuff. We don't want to reuse that if it's intended to be used as a single service. So that's why we have those bin liners. So this is just some generic storage practices that we're going to continue to do to make sure the food that we distribute is as safe and wholesome as possible. Okay, so today we went over a whole bunch of SOPs, standard operating procedures, and hopefully that was not new to you. You're already doing the majority of these things. If you did learn something today, that's great. If you have any questions after today about specific items, my contact info is here. Hopefully you know how to get a hold of me that I can go into more detail with you. I encourage you to keep up the great work and all that you do, and let's continue to make sure that Feeding Northeast Florida distributes as safe and wholesome food as possible. Thank you.